Zig Ziglar said, you can get everything you want in life if you just help enough other people get what they want. Our version of that at Service Express is our vision, which is to work with employees to help them achieve their personal, professional, and financial goals. Our theory is pretty simple. It's that if you surround yourself with the right people and you figure out what they want to achieve at your company and you go to work for them, giving them the opportunity and helping them to achieve those goals, if you added up all those goals and actually helped them achieve them, the company goals would be blown out of the water. And that's what we try to do at Service Express. The way we go about this is every person in our company writes down their vision goals, and it's tracked on our intranet. And they categorize them in a personal, professional, and financial way. And some are short-term goals. We put time frames on them. Is this a now goal? Is it 6 months from now? Is it a year, 5 years, 20 years? What is it that you want to achieve? And what is it that you want to achieve on a personal basis, on a professional basis, and a financial basis? And we want to get details with our people on that. And we sit down, and twice a year, we have what we call formal vision talks, where our management team will sit down with their direct reports, and they'll review the goals. The employees will actually present their goals to their manager and go over with them what they're looking to achieve, talk about what changes have been made. We even talk about what goals have you achieved at Service Express. We have a way we can click on goal that's achieved, and we start to create a list of achieved goals that every employee has since they've joined Service Express. We do this twice a year formally. We do it in January time frame. That's always a great time of year, towards the end of the year, as you're looking forward to the upcoming year and what it is that you want to achieve. And then we do it again in the middle of the year, around June or July, to get an update on it. But it's really got to be more than that for us. It's really got to be better than and more than a poster that we hang on our walls. It's got to be more than a nice phrase that we put together. We really have to live that out. These are goals that we need to be talking about on a monthly, weekly, and daily basis with our employees. It's got to be an ongoing conversation. I had meetings already this week with my top leadership team, and in every one of those meetings, the topic of employees' vision goals came up. As we discussed strategies and opportunities and next steps, we started talking about who had on their goals something that would fit into that. And that's what we're trying to do. It's not just a nice way of doing business. I mean, it sounds nice, and it reads nice, and when we recruit employees, they come in and say, that all sounds good, but it's really more than that. It's our number one strategic objective. This is what we stand for. If you read Jim Collins' Built to Last, he talks about knowing your purpose. What do you stand for as a company? No matter in good times or bad times, or what revenue that you're looking to generate, or what you're looking to do, what do you stand for? This is what Service Express stands for right here. This is what we call our vision. This drives everything that we do. So let's talk about what we do for a minute. We provide on-site data center hardware maintenance. Simply put, we sell service contracts. We're a third-party service provider selling service contracts on IBM, HP, Sun, and Dell hardware, mid-range to high-end servers. Sometimes it's such a niche business that sometimes it's easier to explain it also telling you what we don't do, because this is what people always ask us. We don't do software. We don't do networking. We're not fixing PCs. Don't ask me any questions later about your PC. I don't know the answer. I cannot help you. But it's service contracts on the high-end servers. People ask, how has the economy affected your business? It's actually, I would say, had a positive impact. And I know that sounds funny, and some people kind of get mad at me when I say that. But really, when we're selling service contracts, what we sell, everybody already has a service contract. Our customers, they have it with IBM, HP, Sun, one of the OEMs, maybe a third-party provider like us. And so they're already spending the money that we're looking at. And what we're doing is we're coming in and we're meeting with our customer, we're sitting down with them, and we're trying to find out what are their service requirements, first of all, what kind of hardware do they have, what are their service requirements, and then what are they not getting? What are they unhappy with service-wise, and what are they not getting? What's their wish list? And then we come back with a customized service proposal designed to meet those needs, designed specifically for them, and then we reduce their cost on average 30 to 50%. But the key thing is the service delivery. If we won every deal, if it was all about price, we'd be undefeated. We'd never lose a deal. And the truth is, we measure that, and we win about half the deals we propose. And so it's really about how do you differentiate yourself as a company? What can you do different that they're not currently getting and provide that service? And then at Service Express, being third party, you've got to go out there and prove that. Our biggest challenge is nobody's ever heard of us. We call on customers, and they've never heard of Service Express, but our sales team is good, and we can get the appointment, and we explain to them what we do. And, you know, I say we have the audacity to ask these large companies to give us their high-end servers that are running their whole business, and they've never heard of us. But we have a good story to tell. We have a good service delivery story to tell. We have great references, and we work through that sales process. But our challenge is, the quote that we hear often is, hey, nobody ever got fired for using IBM. Right? So if you have a down server and you have a service contract with IBM and they can't fix it, what do you do as a manager? Like, I'm using IBM. That's what they're telling their manager. If Service Express is in there and you have a down server and we can't fix it, and they go to their boss and say, well, who's working on it? Well, it's this company called Service Express. He said, well, I never heard of them. That guy's in trouble. And so as I tell our employees, we're not playing on an even playing field. But that doesn't matter. I can't change that. That's what we said. We can't change that. So why worry about that? We've got to be better than what the OEM is. All right? And I talk to our customers, and that's why I tell them we are better than them. And they, well, how can you be? I say, well, we use our size to our advantage. Well, they say, well, you're competing against IBM and HP. How could you use size your advantage? We're just smaller, quicker, less red tape. We react a lot quicker than they do. We give customized service. We actually do what they ask you to do. What they want, not the program that we want. We do the program that they're looking for. And basically, we do what we say we're going to do. We back it up. And we're very proud of our 98% customer retention rate that we have in our history. Customers that we focus on are typically customers that have at least 100 employees and do at least $10 million in revenue. They're universities, hospitals, major manufacturing, financial institutions. They've got to be big enough to have a data center and have the mid to high-end servers that we're going to work on. Our revenue breakdown for Service Express, we did $32 million this past year. We're going to do over $36 million this year coming up. 90% of it is contract revenue. So we have a good recurring revenue stream going on. We sell 36-month contracts. 6% of it is hardware sales. We're not an authorized reseller with any partner. We get good deals on hardware that we buy from our vendors. We get great deals that we buy from our customers that we bring in the door. And we can turn around and test, and we can sell back to our customers on the hardware sale and give them a better deal on that. And then when we sell the hardware, we can do the installation, which is time and material services. That's 4% of our revenue. So time and material becomes anything that's not covered under service contract, any hardware installations, and then any data center relocations, which is just moving equipment from one location to another that we've actually been doing. That has been affected the economy as people have downsized some of their hardware. We have increased the number of site moves that we do. Current locations, we mentioned we have 20 offices in 9 states. Right there in red is where we're currently at. Mainly in the Midwest, starting to go into the Southeast, a little bit east over towards Pittsburgh. How we started. Service Express started in 1986 as part of Great Lakes Computer, a hardware reseller, actually located right across the street from us at our current location. And they started in the reseller business. They were selling hardware, and as they were growing their company and selling the hardware, they were doing some installations, similar to what I just mentioned. And as they did a good job at that, some of the customers started to ask them to do some service contracts for them. Well, they were a young, growing company looking for revenue opportunities, so they would say yes to do that, and they started developing the service side of the organization. That went along until 1993, when they decided they wanted to focus solely on hardware, and they had this operations manager that worked for them by the name of Mike McCullough, who's just kind of this high-energy, I call him a little bit crazy kind of guy. And he was looking for something different to do and wanted a new opportunity. And he said, okay, we got an opportunity for you. We want to focus on hardware sales. We're going to create a separate company on the service side. We'll call it Service Express. They gave him some money in a bank. He rented a building, gave him 2 engineers and a salesperson and said, go see what you can do. Try to make something of the service company. So he did that. And he grew the company. And in 1997, he purchased it from Great Lakes. So we're totally separate from Great Lakes Computers now, although great business partners with them currently. Mike brought me on in 1997 as the first manager the company's ever had. I was like the 15th employee at the time, hired me on as a sales manager, and he said, your job is to grow the revenue. I'm going to turn that all over to you. I'll take care of the service side. I'll take care of the operations side. We'll handle any business that you get. You go out and get it. At the time when I came in 97, we finished that year. We had four offices, Grand Rapids, Detroit, South Bend, and Chicago, four salespeople in each office, and we were doing about $2.8 million at the time that I came there. So we started working on growing the company together. In 2000, we expanded our product line. We started out initially, Great Lakes started out really reselling deck hardware, Digital Electronic Corporation, which some of you may know. They were purchased by Compaq, who was then purchased by HP, so it's all rolled up into one now. But as we were out selling service contracts, we noticed that a lot of our customers had this black box sitting in their data center, and we didn't really know anything about it other than it was a different color than the deck boxes that we were working on that were sort of a beige color. Well, these black boxes turned out to be AS400s, manufactured by IBM, and they were everywhere. And so we came back to the service team and said, we could still sell deck, but we're seeing IBM all over the place. And we were seeing more HP at the time, too. We said, we want to go after that hardware. And this is kind of a good story about how we do things. We have a great service team, and they're passionate about working on the hardware. They said, you go sell it. We'll figure it out. That wasn't supposed to be funny, but it was, yeah. Sort of at the time, that's how we did it. And so they went out and found the technical manuals, and they found parts suppliers, and we went out and started selling service contracts. We just took the same program, the same service delivery that we used on the deck hardware and applied it to IBM. It's really not a technical sale. I mean, it can get technical, but you're really selling a service. You're really just asking the customer, what are you looking for in a service provider? And as we grow the company and we watch the major hardware manufacturers try to go to what we call a low-touch, no-touch form of service. They're trying to build these boxes so they never have to talk to you, they never come out, and they think they just run themselves, but they don't. And what we found is our customers still like old-school customer service. They want, when their server's down, they want somebody on-site working on it, and they want them there quick with parts in hand and no excuses, and that's what we provide. That's what we do. So we just took the same service delivery program that we did with DEC and applied it to IBM, HP, and Sun. In 2002, we were continuing to grow the company. We were over $7 million in revenue, and I was running the sales side, and we had my now VP of service, Dwight Strayer, running the service side, and Craig Harper, who a lot of you know, running the operations side, and we were sort of called our three-headed monster that was running the company, and Mike was sometimes in the company, sometimes out. He was kind of half the time he was there and half the time he was away. And we were growing to a point that I think we needed to go to another level as far as the way our leadership was structured. And I approached Mike. We were working on an issue. And as typical issues, I had one way of handling it or approaching it, and Craig had another, and Dwight maybe had another. And we were kind of stuck in the middle there. And so I talked with Mike. We were having a conversation. I just said, look, you've done a great job with this company. I mean, you took something from nothing and has made it into we're a real company now. And that's something I couldn't do. You were the right person there. You're a great entrepreneur. However, we're going to get stuck. We need to become, now that we're becoming a real company, we've got to get some systems and some processes set up, and we've got to really develop this and create a systematic approach to doing it. And I said, I think that's more my strength. You developed me, you trained me, you mentored me, you've taught me the business, and I think I can do it. And I think the company needs one person to sort of make the call and be willing to put their neck on the line and say, we're gonna go this way. And I said, I think that's me. That's the long version. The short version is I went in and fired Mike. I came home and told my wife, and she was a little surprised and shocked. But actually, Mike said, you know, that's a good idea. I get what you're saying, and that makes sense to me. So he said, here's what we'll do. You want to be president? This is our leadership program now. He said, do you want to be president? Go be president. Go do it. Go stick your nose in, you know, the other department's business, figure out what's going on, and we'll see how it goes. And so I walked out of his office as president, except I didn't have the title. I got no increased compensation, and I just got more work to do. So I'm a real skilled negotiator, by the way. That went well. And so I went and started sticking my nose in everybody's business and finding out what was going on, and started talking. We talked with Dwight and Craig, and they were on board. They bought into what was going on. And we started talking with other employees, and they would ask, bring up the idea of me taking over as president. And they would say, well, what are you going to do? and I would explain what I would do and how I'd get involved in situations, kind of set the tone and strategically where we're going. And their comments were back, well, isn't that what you're doing right now? And I said, yeah, really nothing's going to change. I'm just hoping for the title and the increased compensation. And so I got it. In 2002, in July of 2002, I got it. And Mike named me president of the company and packed up his office and left. And I bring this up as a story. I tell these stories to a lot of people and a lot of small business owners, and they always hear that with envy. And they're like, how did he do that? I would love to do that. You mean he doesn't come back? I'm like, well, not that often. You know, we send him financials. My job is to make him so happy he doesn't have to come back. We meet for breakfast and we talk, and he still sees the financials and everything. But that was always Mike's plan. He wanted to build a company and create an opportunity for somebody else to come in and run it. He said it from the beginning, and he just executed it. That was the difference right there. So I took over as president. Luckily, we continued to grow at 20% a year. And in 2006, we sort of hit another milestone. We were growing. Things were going great. But again, we looked at it, our setup, and said, you know, we're not going to be able to keep up this pace. I had one sales manager at the time, Mark Thomas, who's now my VP of sales. And he had about 13 or 14 salespeople reporting to him in seven or eight different offices. And he's great at sales, and he was driving revenue. But this was not sustainable. Mark was going to get burned out on this. And it wasn't. He was gone too much. It wasn't good work-life balance for Mark. And that's something that we believe in at Service Express as well. And if you're burning out your employees and things aren't good at home, you're going to ultimately have a losing end game at your company. And so we looked at that and said, we need to look for other leaders. And so part of our vision talks that we'd been having with employees, we identified salespeople who had on their vision goals that they wanted to get into leadership. And so taking the same structure I got, as I wanted to move into president, I said, well, if you want to be a leader, we'll give you opportunities to be a leader. And so we gave them opportunities to help out with pricing, do some training, go on sales calls, and do all the things a sales manager does. And they got the same title and comp plan that I did, which was nothing. They just got permission. You know, it's laugh, but what's funny is that's really a good gut test. And we really were able to weed out who was looking for the title and the money and trying to climb the corporate ladder, and who was really passionate about helping others. And that's what we're looking for as leaders at Service Express, is who has that servant leadership mentality, who wants to pour into others. And I tell you, there's no truer test than a salesperson, because every moment they spend helping somebody else, not only am I not paying them extra for it, it's literally taking money out of their pocket because they're paid on commission. And so I found out real quick who had the heart of a leader, and that's who I promoted to regional sales manager. There was three of them. Now, they were great at sales, but they also had the heart of the leader. And those are two different skill sets, by the way, if there's any sales managers in here, any owners. A sales manager and a top salesperson is two completely different skill sets that we look for. So that was a scary point. So I took three of my top people out of the field. But the goals were still 15, 20% of revenue every year. The idea was, if they could get 8 to 10 people to sell, that's creating far more revenue and opportunities than just what they could sell. When you're in sales, there's only so much you can do in a day, but if you can get 8 people to sell, 10 people to sell, now you become what we call a multiplier. And at Service Express, the job description, quite simply, for a sales manager is not to grow sales. It's to grow salespeople. None of my sales managers are selling in the field. Their total compensation is based on other people getting results. They may have to an emergency handle an account here or there, but they don't ever get paid on it like a salesperson. They get paid on it like a sales manager. They have to get results through people. I don't believe you can do a dual side there. If you're trying to do both, you're paying both ways. Typically, that person's going to slide towards doing their own deal and just try to get whatever they can off who's reporting to them. So we totally flip that, and you have to get results through others. In 2009, we opened up another location here in Grand Rapids. We call the BTC, which is the Broadmoor Technical Center. It's a 25,000-square-foot warehouse and training center. We built our current building in 1999. We expanded it in 2006 when we ran out of room. And in the 2009, we were running out of room again. And instead of building onto it again, we opened up another facility that all of our parts come into. We have a training set up in there. We've developed our own internal technical training. We have our own certifications that we actually believe or take pride in the fact that they're harder than what the manufacturer does. We've hired people away from IBM, HP, and Sun. They've taken our tests. We love them when they come in a little cocky and like, I've been working on this for years, and we'll go through that, and I get grins right here because it happens. And then they fail our test. And we're like, well, you're at Service Express now. You're not that easy job, IBM or whatever. You're here. The bar's been raised at Service Express. So we take a little bit of, have a little bit of fun with that. But that's created some opportunities for us as we continue to grow hardware revenue. One of the vision goals we had from Jake Blau, my warehouse manager, he came up and told me one day years ago, he said, I'm going to be our number one vendor. Right now we buy parts from everybody else. We can become our own number one vendor by buying the right parts ourselves and stock them here in Grand Rapids, and we'll supply our other offices. We stock parts locally in every office that we have. And Jake went out and made that happen. He did so good at it, we got him a building and said, do more of it. And then he turned around, and as we bought in pallets, Jake's a great success story. His dad was a junk man. He was raised in a junkyard, and Jake has taken that talent and applied it to computer parts. He brings in pallets of hardware. He has a great eye for knowing what works, what's valuable. We test it. We put it on our shelves. We use it. The OEMs say things are end of life. They try to talk you into buying something new, a new server, because they say they're not going to make it anymore. End of life is just the beginning for us. There's parts up to 10 years or more that are available on the reseller market. Jake goes out and finds them, and we get those and maintain them. And then he figured out how to sell the stuff that we don't want, that we'd normally get rid of. He threw it on this website called BrokerBin, and now he's created $50,000 a month in revenue just selling the stuff that we don't want. That's a vision goal. That's what happens when you put somebody, you figure out what they want to do and give them the opportunity to do it. And so that's a new revenue generator for us. Revenue growth goals, here's been our steady climb right here. 20% annually on average over the past 10 years. Our whole philosophy is to stay aggressive with growth, but be controlled. We're a service company. We don't believe you can grow faster than you can grow your people. If we start growing too fast and we can't keep up with it on the service side, that's going to crash and burn on us. So we want to stay aggressive. We're totally growth mode all the time. We never talk about not growing. We don't care what the economy is doing, whether it's good or bad. We try to focus on what we can control, and our goal is growth, and it's 15 to 20% a year, and that's what we've been able to accomplish. You know, we struggled with that a little bit back in 98, 99, 2000 with the dot-coms and companies exploding, and here we are growing 20% a year, and it just didn't seem like enough at the time. Now, looking back, sometimes those guys look at us with a little bit of envy and like, wow, you're growing 20% a year. That seems like a lot. But it's just something, you know, it adds up over time, and that's what we're trying to do, something that's sustainable. Our growth strategy. Again, Jim Collins, if you've read Built to Last and Good to Great, he talks about getting the right people on the bus and the right people in the right seats. So there's the SEI bus right there. And that's what we start with, is getting the right people on the bus, getting them on the right seat, taking somebody who's great in the junkyard and giving them opportunity to get them on the seat of the bus in a warehouse to have an impact there. And then McDonald's, if you listen to Michael Gerber, who does the E-Myth, it's one of his older programs called Taking Charge of Your Business and Your Life, and we listened to that, probably listened to that a dozen times, and he talks about building up systematic processes, repeatable processes. Don't rely just on people. Someone here in this office is good at that. Someone over here is good at that. It's got to be repeatable processes that can sustain your growth. I disagree with Gerber a little bit. He thinks that everything is processes, and he uses McDonald's as the model that you can take, you know, young kids, create a process and kick out results. And maybe for a $1 billion company, you can over time. For our size, it's not quite that simple. We have found that if you have great processes but the wrong people, you only go so far. If you have great people but you don't have the right systems, then you're just totally relying on that person and what their skill set is and hoping you can find another one like them. So if we can combine the right people with the right repeatable process, that's how we create our growth. So we're really trying to create a franchise model. You know, we have the 20 offices right now. We've really tried to create a franchise model of what we call the SCI way. This is how we do business in every location we're in. I don't care if you're in Grand Rapids, if you're in the big city of Chicago, if you're south in Nashville, or if you're over in Pittsburgh. We sell the same way. We service the same way. We count inventory the same way. Our offices look the same. We have a blueprint now when we go into a new office. How much square foot do we get? How much is office space? How much is warehouse space? How much is office space that we get in? How many salespeople do we need? It's systematic across the board. And what we found is when you're systematized across the board, when there's an error, you see it repeated over and over in different locations, and you fix the system. If you've got the right people on board, I mean, I'm not telling you anything new. This is Jim Collins, not me, right? If you've got the right people on board and you've got an issue, you've got a system problem. So we fix the system. But if we're not doing everything the same way, I don't know what's going on in Chicago or Detroit or Nashville if they're all doing it the same way. So that was one of the big things we were passionate about from the beginning. And as I came on as president, we really had to take hold. We are going to do everything the same way across the board. There's one way. It's what we call the SEI way. And that's how we've been able to create that model that we can grow into and has more ramp-up room. And then the way we make decisions at the company is our four core objectives. Again, I'll steal from Jim Collins when he talks about what are your core values. By the way, I referenced a lot of these books and stuff. I got to tell you, I have a teaching degree from Central Michigan, and I know nothing about technology, so I'm highly unqualified to be up here and running this company. But I can read these books that are the best practices that are available out there, and I can take what they say and I can apply them to what goes on in our business. And so we read Jim Collins' Built to Last, and he talked about the core values, and we came up with what our core values were at the company. Really, Mike sat down and came up with this. And it was four of them. It was excellent customer service. We've talked about our 98% customer retention rate, which isn't good enough for us. Every year, our goal is 100%. We never, ever want to lose an account due to service. I don't care how big we get. We'll go into every year saying we're not going to lose one this year due to service. It's revenue growth, which I've talked about. That growth provides opportunities for other people. We talk about our vision goals. You can't help people take advantage of those opportunities if you're not growing as a company. My best people will leave if I don't continue to grow and create those opportunities. They'll go somewhere else to get them. I don't want Service Express to be a stepping stone for anybody else. I want I sell people in our company. Where you were at before is the stepping stone to get you here at Service Express, and you should be able to achieve everything you want right here. Margin retention and growth. I tell our employees, I tell our customers, we make money. We are not a not-for-profit. Okay? We are profitable. I tell our customers, you want us to make money. If I don't make money, I can't invest in parts, I can't invest in people, I can't invest in office space, I can't invest in things I need to do to provide great service. We're blessed with a couple of great owners that say that we want a certain return on the company. It's a business deal. But then other than that, we're going to reinvest in the company so that we can keep going and keep creating the opportunities that have gotten us here. So we're going to make margin. And then employee engagement. And fully involved employees who strive to impact others. If you're an A-player at Service Express, it's not good enough just to do your job great. You've got to do your job great, and you've got to do it in a way that impacts other people and allows them to do their job great. You've got to impact our customers externally, and you've got to impact other departments within the company. You can't just go sell deals. You've got to sell the right deals that we can service properly, that we can support internally properly. My analogy I always use in the company is it's like four, and these guys have heard it, it's like four legs on a table. And if you get one leg shorter than the other or longer than the other, you got a wobbly table. This is our guideline right here. And if one of these gets out of whack, then we've got a wobbly company. If we're growing too fast and we're burning out our employees trying to keep up with it, customer service is going to start to slip, employees are going to get burned out and leave, and that revenue growth we're so proud of is going to come crashing down. It's not going to be sustainable. And at the same time, as I mentioned, if we're not growing, we're not creating opportunities for our people, they'll leave. Or we won't be able to make the money that we need to reinvest to take care of our customers. And so we use the four core objectives as a benchmark for every decision that we make. Every employee knows this. It's not just supposed to be a poster on the wall. We're supposed to use this. The conversations I want to have with our people, whatever decision they make, is break it down from me on our four core objectives. Why did you make that decision? If we disagree, that's okay. I don't even care if they give me the wrong answer. I just want them to think and break it down through there. And sometimes they convince me I had the wrong answer. And sometimes I convince them and we get on the same page, but we're learning together and we're applying the business concepts of Service Express so they can be more empowered to do their job better. SR5 is what we call our performance measurement system. We believe what gets measured gets done. We measure everything at Service Express. So SR5 stands for scorecards, ROIs, and 515s. We have our scorecards. We have our balanced scorecard, which is company-wide, our key measurements across the board. We can break that down by department. We can break that down by region. We can break it down by office. What are the trends going on in the company? What are we seeing out there? We try to use that to see trends and then try to use it to predict the future. If this happened then, what's going to happen in the next 90 days? What's going to happen 6 months from now? ROIs are an individual job description with all measurable results. Everybody at Service Express has a measurable job description. I could pull up right now anybody in the company, including myself, pull up their ROIs and see what are they responsible for and how do we measure it. And we review those every month with every employee, every manager does, and we see how are they doing. Are they hitting their goals? It takes a lot of the subjectivity out of whether somebody's performing or not. It makes it a lot easier when you give feedback at review time and at annual compensation time. So it is a performance mentality that we have. And then the 5 stands for 5-15, which is we do that on a quarterly basis, and that's our goals and priorities for the upcoming quarter, really based on around what their vision goals are, what they're looking to achieve, and what are they going to focus on in the next 90 days. And then we'll review that after the quarter, and did you accomplish what you set out to do? Did you move the ball forward? And if we get everybody on the team, everybody in the company, and every individual, again, myself included, I do this, and everybody took a step forward and we moved it forward after 90 days, we're making progress. We're growing. Our recruiting. The Island of Misfit Toys, if you recognize that slide. Mike and I, we always jokingly, that's what we call ourselves, the Island of Misfit Toys. We're just dumb enough to believe that if you work and help other people achieve their goals, it can add up to sustained growth. And so we're looking for people that have that same belief. And that's why we call it, because we get told all the time, this won't work. This won't sustain. You're in a dying industry. People, you won't find enough of the right people. You won't be able to sustain the growth. Mike told me he heard it when he hired me. I've heard it since he's brought me in. We continue to hear that. So we're not trying to convince anybody what we're doing is right. And I'm up here telling my story. I'm not trying to convince anybody. We're just sharing our story, and we're just looking for people who think like we do, who say, I think that can be done too. Can I come join that? That's what we're looking to do. We have a very detailed recruiting process. It's a 6-step recruiting process that takes 6 to 8 weeks to go through with a phone interview. We do a Gallup profile on them. Everybody that hires in our company has to do a ride-along, a day on the job. I don't care if you're answering the phones, if you're taking service or sales calls, you're going to spend a day at Service Express job shadowing that position to really find out what it's like here. We want the people who are looking for a job to really get as good a look at us as we do at them. We want them checking us out because after 90 days, we're going to know. We're both going to know, are we the real deal? So let's spend the time up front to do that. So we're very selective about who we bring in to our company. Revenue projections for the next 10 years. Hopefully it's going to look a lot like the last 10 years were. It's sustained growth. It's no longer really 20%. It's really our goals are 15%, and as the revenue number gets bigger, the percentage gets smaller. And so when we get to 2020, our what we call our BHAG, our big hairy audacious goal, is $100 million in revenue by 2020. And we can do that by growing 15% a year. Really in 2020, we're growing 10% at that time. If we can do 20%, great. If we can do it in the normal course of our business, if we're all performing and we hit it, absolutely great. But I don't want to sit back in my office and say we're going to absolutely do 20% this year and make a bunch of bad short-term decisions just to hit a number. Our whole objective is to do the right thing, and when we come out and look at the numbers, they're going to be there. And then finally, our future locations. We talked about expansion. The blue cities there, that's where we're looking to go. We want to continue to go into the Midwest and down into the Southeast. Everybody's excited about Florida. That we're supposed to be, especially on days like today, everybody wants to go to Florida. In the summertime, they're not so sure, but we want to get to Florida within the next 3 years. And I'll finish by wrapping this up into our vision, too. The way we talk about expanding, we're going to go to Minneapolis by the end of this year because I have a service engineer in Flint who has it on his vision goal that he wants to move to Minneapolis. We're supposed to go there 2 or 3 years from now. We've moved it up to this year because he wants to go. Why wouldn't I want to build around an established person? He's an A player. He's one of my top engineers. Why would I not want to go start a service office around him? So we'll move him to Minneapolis, and we'll go attack it. We're going to be in Charlotte, in North Carolina, in 2 years from now because I have a sales manager in Milwaukee who has it on his vision goals. He's had it on there for 3 years that he wants to relocate to North Carolina. But he promised his son, he promised his family, he promised himself he would not take him out of high school. When he was in high school, he got moved his senior year to a new school. He hated it, and he said, I'll never do that. So he told me, I want to go there and open that up, but I cannot go until my youngest son is out of high school. And we said, we'll wait. We don't need to go before there's plenty of opportunity. When he's ready, you can go. And I think he's tried to, he's brought up the question a number of times to see if he's ready yet, but he's holding firm and wants to wait, so we'll wait. And we'll go to North Carolina when he's ready. We'll be in Florida in 3 years because I have a service manager and a salesperson that have it on their vision that they want to relocate to Florida. That's where they want to go. So we're going to go to Florida. We're going to open up in Tampa area, and we're going to build off of there. We're going to take over the whole state of Florida from that side. It's all built around what are the goals on our employees' visions. And you know, one thing about visions too, I'll just say, sometimes it's not a relocation, it's not a new title. I have one of our top salesperson. You know what's on his vision goal? Please don't make me a sales manager. I don't want to do that job. I know what I can do. I run my own business. I get great results. I know what I'm responsible for. That's what I want to do. I don't want to be responsible for others. That's on his vision goals, and that's what we're going to promise him. You do not want to take that person and make him a manager. And so part of a vision goal can be, this is just what I want to keep doing the rest of the year, so the rest of my career. So that's our story of Service Express. That's how we've done it. Again, I appreciate everybody coming out tonight, and thank you again for the award. We're very proud of it. And at this time, if there's any questions, or we'll open it up.